We want to say happy Sabbath to everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
It's such a blessing for us to be here this morning. Amen.
Amen.
God has been good to us.
Amen.
Who says that money don't grow in trees? I read a story in the Bible where a fish was looking for a man that gave him some money. Have you ever came across that story?
No.
First time I saw that the fish was looking for Peter. Men go fishing, and the Bible says the fish was looking for a man. And as we started this morning, even Jonah, fish was looking for him, amen? For those of you who love titles, I've entitled the message, Accustomed to Being in Charge. Shall we pray? Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy, for your kindness towards us, and for being in this house of worship. And we are saying like the psalmist David, as we open your words, open our minds, and give us understanding. And may we learn something that will draw us closer to you. Speak to me, through me, and for me. And we will be careful to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Now, a steward is one who is in charge of another person's goods. He is not the owner, but he is in charge of somebody else's stuff. And in reality, we are not owners. But we have been entrusted with somebody else's property, and there comes a day of accountability. What have you done with the stuff I gave to you? But we are tempted at times to forget that we are in charge of another person's goods. We think that we are the owners. And this seldom happens to individuals who have some stuff. A person who has power, or they're in a position of authority. A person who has accumulated wealth, think that they have gotten it by their own might, their own wisdom. Let us never forget that we are in charge of another person's stuff. Those of you who love titles have entitled a message, Accustomed to Being in Charge. And it's a very subtle deception from the devil. As a matter of fact, it started with him way back many years ago, way up in glory. Ezekiel 28 tells us that he was perfect in the day that he was created. And this is a mystery. He was perfect, living in a perfect environment. There was no taint of sin. There was no discord. Everything was in harmony, perfect harmony, till iniquity was found in him. Now the Bible tells us that there are two mysteries in the scriptures. The mystery of godliness, because God is past finding out. We can never figure out God, amen?
Amen.
All that we know about God is what is revealed in His Word, in the person of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
What is not revealed, we cannot speculate. Amen?
Amen?
And the mystery of iniquity. Sin didn't have to happen, but it did. And it will always remain mysteries. Amen? He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Amen.
So we believe in God, and that belief in God, that belief to believe in God comes from him.
Amen.
That initial faith to believe in God comes from him.
Mm-hmm.
And that saving faith comes from him. It is not in us. There is no inner goodness or any good thing in us that draws us to Him. The Bible says He draws us to Him. Amen?
Amen.
By the goodness of God, His mercy, His grace, His kindness, He draws us to Himself. God is a loving Heavenly Father.
Amen.
But we read in our scripture reading that Jesus says that He is the Alpha and the Omega. Now that is the first and last letters of the Greek alphabet. Now if you are the Alpha and the Omega, you are the beginning and the end, that tells me you are the one who is in charge. Because beside Him there is no other.
Amen.
He is the beginning and the ending.
Amen.
Have you ever thought about that? We cannot even begin to conceive the beginning.
Yes.
We can, in a minute way, try to understand there is no ending, but to begin to understand no beginning? I mean, I've asked myself the question sometimes, where did God came from? There must be a beginning, but God has always existed. There was never time when God was not. He has always been, and He will always be.
Amen.
That's why when He told Moses, when Moses asked the question, who shall I say, send me to tell you, Pharaoh, to let my people go? God said to Moses, tell him that I am.
Yeah.
The ever-present God, I am. In other words, what I'm trying to say, God is going to where He has been coming from. He is God.
Amen.
He has no beginning and no ending. And that to me is mind-boggling.
Amen.
We can begin to imagine eternity. And I've kind of tried to explain it like this. Imagine with me in your imagination, a bird traveling for thousands of miles, and he ends up in the ocean, and he takes one drop of water in his beak. And then that bird travels back for thousands of miles and spends 1 million years. Then after 1 million years, he comes back to that same spot and takes another drop of water in his beak and then goes back for 1 million years. Now how long do you think that bird will take to drain the Atlantic or the Pacific Ocean? And when that happens, that's only the beginning of eternity. It's just amazing. There is no ending where God is concerned. But everything in this life, and even all of us, and all that we have, all that we possess, is of a temporal existence. Nothing in this life lasts forever. It will come to an end. And sooner or later, you and I will be reduced to ashes. And those of us who are getting there, we are wearing out. With old age and old age, we lose our sight, we lose our hearing, our teeth begin to drop out, our knees begin to shake, we are afraid of heights. And everything that is connected to old age, as soon as we are born, we begin an inexorable march toward the grave. As soon as we are born, we begin to die. And we don't learn the lessons of history, and we, as fools, gallop on the same horse, and we don't learn the lessons of history.
Amen.
And we make a fool of our lives. Accustomed to being in charge. I turn your attention to the book of Daniel. What book did I say?
Daniel.
That's in the Old Testament. Ezekiel, Daniel. Very familiar book. And Nebuchadnezzar was in charge. As a matter of fact, God chose a heathen king to reveal to him what will come in the last days, from his time to the very end of time. Now Nebuchadnezzar made 3 trips to Jerusalem, and in his third encounter, he flattened the city and he took the best with him. And in that group were the elite, the best, the brightest, the brilliant minds, the youths that were in Jerusalem. And he took them and he placed them in the University of Babylon to be educated, to be trained, to be taught in the language and the culture of Babylon. And then he would send them out as ambassadors to represent Great Babylon. There was nothing in his constitution that he went contrary. He was the authority. That was the greatest nation upon the face of the earth at that time. He was the greatest king, and he ruled the greatest kingdom. And historians tell us that this was one of the 7 wonders of the world, the Golden Kingdom. And there's something about power. And we see it today amongst world leaders, amongst politicians. There's something about power that the more you have is the more you want. You ask a millionaire after he makes his first million, what is your next goal? To make my 2nd million. It never stops. When you get the first house, you want to get another. You get the first car, you want to get another, something better, something bigger. And you're always striving for more. But it's going to burn one of these days. And as a matter of fact, all of us sitting here today is going to pass through the fire, sooner or later. All of us are going to go to the crucible. And Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, and Daniel explained the dream to him. Now, this is a very familiar passage, so you know the story. I don't need to go into details. 13 years had transpired after the dream. Now, when Daniel explained the dream to Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel chapter 2, Nebuchadnezzar, for a while, worshipped the God of heaven.
Yes.
Can you imagine? You dreamt something, and all the wise men, the Chaldeans, the soothsayers, the fortune tellers, they couldn't explain the dream. And there is this slave from Jerusalem, explained the dream. And the Bible says that Nebuchadnezzar fell on his face and worshipped Daniel. But he went beyond his bounds. He set a decree that no one should worship any other god.
Okay.
Now we see what happened in history is playing out even today. Amen?
Amen.
Now let's pick it up from Daniel chapter 3, where Nebuchadnezzar decided to... Sometimes we forget, so soon we forget how God has led us. And in Daniel chapter 3, Nebuchadnezzar wanted his kingdom to last forever. So he made this great image, entirely of gold. The Bible scholars tell us it was 90 to 100 feet tall. Can you imagine full of gold? Can you imagine a 10-story building? And he put it up in the plains of Dura. That's where the Kurds resided before Saddam Hussein perched. He did not set it up amongst the forest, the trees. He did not set it up amongst the mountains, but he set it up in a plain where it could have been seen for miles and miles. Can you imagine when the sun rose and that that his God would glow. And he decided to convene a council of world leaders. This was no ordinary celebration. This was a grand celebration. Anybody who was somebody was invited. Of course, Daniel was out of town, and he had the music. Babylonish music. He had all kinds of music. And all his entourage, his leaders, his cabinet members, his guests, were told all you need to do is bow down and worship the image. Now this is a very simple thing, what do you say? All you need to do is bow down and worship the image. And he had a way of getting your ego going. If you do not bow, there's a furnace. Now that wouldn't get anybody going, what do you say? All you need to do is bow and save your life. If you do not bow, that's your alternative. All you need to do is bow. Now there are three individuals, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, well, the Babylonian name Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We pick it up in verse 17. And I want you to notice what they said. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O King. Now, if the passage had stopped there, that would have been all right. But what disturbed me is the next verse. But if not, be it known unto you, unto thee, O King, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Now Nebuchadnezzar was in charge. The Hebrew boys, now it should have been four, because Zedekiah was there as well, the puppet king that Nebuchadnezzar had set up in Jerusalem. There were many Seventh-day Adventists in that crowd, in the congregation here. Who bowed? If Zedekiah had stood up, it would have been four. That's what the record says. But these three individuals, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, said, the God whom we serve, he is able to deliver us. But the next verse disturbed me. But if not, we're still not going to bow. You see, it was not their kind of music. It was not their kind of God. Amen? Now, if you don't stand for something, you're going to fall for anything. There's coming a time when every one of us are going to be tested and tried as though there is not another upon the face of this earth. God is going to see what kind of material we are made of, whether we are made of costume, jewelry, or the real thing. Amen? Yeah. It's coming. I imagine that Nebuchadnezzar must have said, now remember that you are slaves. I've given you nice jobs, pleasure apartment, suites. You have a nice view of the city. You have fine clothing according to your choice. I've put you in my university. I've given you Friday nights and Sabbaths off. All I'm asking you, now remember, everyone is looking, you're making me look bad. All eyes are on you. You're making me look bad. Can you imagine? Nebuchadnezzar loved these individuals, amen? Because he's given them another chance. Could he not just take the vaccine, this one, I mean, could you not bow? This once? Just one time. My patience is running out. Have you heard those words for the past 2 weeks? I don't need to read between the lines. You know what I'm saying, amen? Now, America is a lamb-like beast that speaks as a dragon. It has been speaking for a dragon for some time now. I remember when President George Bush decided to go to war, the United Nations says no. And Bush says, who are you? And the United Nations has lost its respect. Bush says, we're going to war. And he did go to war, amen? Mm-hmm. Speaking as a dragon. And Nebuchadnezzar decided to heat the furnace 7 times hotter in that oil-rich soil. There were coal pits, and there were chemicals that they could have extracted from the soil and heat that furnace. The scholars tell us you could not heat it more than it was heated already. But there are chemicals that you could have extracted from the soil, because the Bible tells us that the men, the elite, the strongest men in his military, took hold of these individuals. Let's read what it says here. These men were born, now the Bible is very specific in verse 21. These men were born in the courts, in the hosen, that's the socks, the hats, the other garments, and were cast in the midst of the fiery furnace. Nebuchadnezzar was enraged. Now you don't disrespect authority. One of the in the constitution of this country, one of the lawyers, everyone must obey the law. The government, the president, every citizen, and no one is above the law.
That's right.
Amen? It's the civil law of the land. Nebuchadnezzar was not going contrary to his constitution. But these men were bound. And they were thrown in the fiery furnace. And the Bible says that the men who threw them in died. But Nebuchadnezzar was looking. Imagine with me. They said that the God whom we serve is able to deliver us. But if not, we still are going to bow. They had all the privileges that Nebuchadnezzar gave to them. The opportunities, the education. Now Nebuchadnezzar was looking. Now what also disturbed me in verse 25? He answered and said, let's back up a little bit. Verse 24. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished and rose up in haste and spake and said unto his counselors, did not we cast 3 men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said unto the king, true, O king. He answered and said, lo, I see 4 men loose, walking in the midst of the fire. And this is the part that got to me. And they have no hurt, and the form of the 4th is like the Son of God.
Right.
Now the Bible does not tell us how he knew the 4th individual looked like. Neither does the spirit of prophecy.
That's right.
So I had to retract and come up with a good argument. I had to go back to Daniel chapter 2, where Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. And in that golden image, he also saw a stone cut out without hands. And he smote the image. And then it grew and became a great mountain, and it lasted forever. That stone represented Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So what Nebuchadnezzar was saying, I saw him before, and look!
There he is again.
There he is!
Yes, sir.
I saw him! Amen. The form of the fort is like the Son of God. Verse 26, then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God. Now why did he say ye servants of the Most High God? You see, in his mind, his God was the highest God there is. His God was 100 feet solid gold. But when he saw this miracle, this deliverance, he said that your God is higher than my God.
Amen.
He's servants of the Most High God. Your God is bigger than my God. Amen.
Amen.
He says, you come out. In other words, that was good sense. You come out and you come here. I'm not going where you are. Amen. Come out and come where I am. That was good thinking. And verse 29, the latter part says, there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. There is no other God who can deliver like this. Oh, God is amazing. Amen.
Amen.
Even when we don't see any way of deliverance. I'm here to remind us that God has 1,000 ways of resolving our situation where we don't even see one.
Amen. Amen.
At the darkest moment of our lives, God is nearest to us.
Yes.
Amen.
And the greatest blessing is right around the corner.
Amen.
Praise
God.
Hold
on. Amen.
He's testing us to see whether we are in charge or he is in charge.
Amen. Amen.
We are never in charge, friend of mine, of our lives. We are being coerced. We are being driven by one force or the other. We are being controlled by one or the other. Christ says himself, you cannot serve two masters. So whether we are allowing one to control us or the other. Amen?
Amen.
I hope to see Nebuchadnezzar in heaven, because in the next chapter he had another dream. And Daniel explained the dream to him in chapter 4. Oh, he lost his mind. Imagine he lost his mind for 7 years. Imagine this. He lost his mind for 7 years. And then one day he looked up into heaven and his sanity came back to him. And he just walked into his palace and sat down on the throne. No one took him. He just walked back and sat down on the throne. And this is what he said. Verse 37, chapter 4. Now Nebuchadnezzar praised and extolled and honored the King of heaven, all whose works are true, and his ways judgment, and those that walk in pride he is able to abase. All who walk in pride, self-sufficient, those who think that they're in charge, the big kahunas, the authority. All our works will come to an end one of these days. Amen?
Amen.
You know, I'm sure you must have met people in life, and when they get to a certain position, and they sit down in their office, and you enter the office, they can't even remember you.